Today, I'd like to propose a neo-organodynamism as a minimally necessary theoretical classification of mental illness. My presentation is in four parts. First, I'll give a brief introduction to understand the history of psychiatry and classification of mental illness. Next, I'd like to describe early AIDS organodynamism and its problems. Then, I'll show my new organodynamism and a new practical classification of mental illness. Finally, I'll talk about treatment concept by my new organodynamism, and I'll show how to record a psychiatric chart neo-organodynamically. Let me start with the introduction. Biologists and psychologists have based on the Cartesian mind-body dualism. Psychiatric history includes the struggle between biology and psychology. Although I know that Sigmund Freud said, we'll have to find a contact point with biology. Dogmatically conflicting psychological and biological theories make the foundation of psychiatry fragile, leaving mental illness without a clear system of classification. French psychiatrist Henri A, he called this chaos psychiatricite and attempted to break with it. He partially applied the theories of John Fielding Jackson, Pierre Janet, and Henri Bergson, especially the Jacksonism as a base. He proposed the theory of organodynamism. Henri Bergson considered time as a concept that can't be divided. In the same way, consciousness may be seen as an indivisible entity. Bergson calls the stream of consciousness durée, which means duration. He argued that actual being is a durée between a relaxed state, which is body as a material, and a tense state, which is mind as storage. In addition, Bergson speaks of the mind's energy as an élan vital, a vital impetus, a notion analogous to Pierre Janet's concept of tension psychology. The reduction of the mind's energy may be an important aggravating factor of insanity. On the basis of Bergson's theories, I hypothesize mental illness. A mental activity is also an indissoluble durée, and that insanity is a stream of the duration between a relaxed state, which is normal or chronic phase, and a tense one, which is acute or aggravation phase. The mentally ill don't remain in one state. According to my theory of the neo-organodynamism, which I discuss here, the phase should be transformed into another. In next slide, we consider the traditional classification of mental illness and its problems. Mental disorders are currently classified by the multi-axial system of the DSM-4-TR. This multi-axial system confuses etiological factors with symptomatic ones, making it difficult to treat psychosis. It lacks the flexibility to avoid the overlapping diagnostic criteria of each disease. It also doesn't consider the importance of the hierarchy of symptoms and their subordinate relationships. And then in traditional nosology, the diagnosis of mental illness is dependent on its severity and on endogenous or exogenous factors. Insanity is divided into primary disorders, which are congenital or intrinsic, and secondary ones, which is acquired or exogenous. However, it is impossible to distinguish between symptoms that arise from deep tissue in the process of psychic dissolution and disturbances that are caused exogenously. Next, we try to consider early AIDS classification of mental illness and organodynamism and its problems. Organodynamism is a psychobiological hypothesis that sees the origin of mental illness as organic, and the symptoms are the expression of the dynamic features of mental structure. A considers psychic dissolution the sum of positive and negative symptoms as the foundation of mental illness. The negative symptoms and dysfunction of the higher level of neural function are related to organic dysfunctions. The symptoms produced by the anarchic state of the disintegrated lower levels are called positive symptoms. This is a way of thinking of neo-Jacksonism. Thus, this concept is different from a classification schema that stresses the positive and the negative symptoms of schizophrenia. A classifies mental illness into acute and chronic psychosis. The former are characterized by acute transient symptoms, acute or epileptic onset, and relatively long episodes. They can easily reoccur, and those suffering from them have a tendency to recover, if only incompletely. Chronic psychosis, in comparison, are characterized by continuous deterioration. Then I show you A's classification of mental disorder. This is not a desktop theory. He produced it from his experiences as a psychiatrist. A classifies mental illness into two categories according to the depth of the psychic dissolution, acute psychosis as pathologies of consciousness, and chronic psychosis and neurosis as pathologies of personality. The lower position of the disorder in this slide indicates a deeper psychic dissolution. The symptoms are reversible. The dissolution of consciousness of a personality can alter with time. A classifies bipolar disorder as an acute psychosis. In the sense of having a potential to aggravate, bipolar disorder may be classified into the chronic psychosis. But the cause of this disease is acute onset, and it has a natural tendency to lessen in intensity. Therefore, he classified it as an acute psychosis. As for the clinical picture with organ dynamism, it might be the appearance of depth of the psychic dissolution. The problem that touch both these fields can't be explained well by the theory of organ dynamism. For example, when the illness phase of bipolar disorder as a consciousness disturbance is seen in the patient with schizophrenia, it appears as a personality disturbance. He explains this phenomenon as the expansion of chronic mental illness into the field of personality, which may sometimes include disturbances of consciousness that sometimes take on a continuous organized form. The degree of reaction threshold is seen in some types of personality disturbances, and this event makes the appearance of the acute psychosis and its continuous organization easy. However, this problem can't be explained only by decreasing the response threshold. Furthermore, sustainable organization of the acute psychosis results in chronic psychosis, which contradicts AIDS classification. Separating mental illness into acute and chronic states is not sufficient. It can't explain the psychic dynamic process at work. AIDS theory is not clear. What is the depth of the solution of consciousness and personality disturbance? What is the factor that speculates the depth of psychotic dissolution in personality dysfunction? I'd like to propose a neo-organodynamism as a hypothesis which can solve these problems. Personality is an entire mental functional state, bearing in mind that the most disruptive state of personality dysfunction is dementia and mental retardation. The degree of organic degeneration may be the determinant factor of psychic dissolution. The organic dissolution also includes the abnormalities in the genetic level. This is not to support just a single causative gene. The different genes have the possibility of displaying the same phenotypes that are symptoms as a result under the same psychological or social conditions. In the same manner, the most disruptive state of consciousness dysfunction is epilepsy. The degree of the abnormal firing in the neural network might be the speculative factor of psychic dissolution. If the transformation of the acute phase stems from abnormal firing, this phenomenon may explain why symptoms of this phase may be transient. This theory can also explain why antiepileptics contribute to the stability of mental states in acute psychosis, including bipolar disorder. In addition, it makes clear why the illness image of all psychosis may be observed in the epileptic psychosis. I will show you next a new practical classification of mental illness that was derived from the theory of neo-organodynamism. If we adopt the viewpoint as presented in this slide, that the acute phase of disease may only be a temporary modification of the basic mental illness, The nature of the latter can be expressed in terms of the depth of the organic degeneration. The intensity of psychotic states, both the basic disorder and its acute aggravated phase, is in proportion to the degree of abnormal neural firings. In my classification, mental illness is classified from a normal stage N or N plus to a stage 10, and the degree of acute aggravation is staged from 0 to 7. The 12 stages of organic degeneration multiplied by the 8 stages of acute aggravation resulted in a product of 19.6. That is, it is possible to diagnose 19.6 state of mental illness. By applying this classification to diagnosis, we can accurately represent the condition of a psychiatric patient that change near organodynamically over time. Furthermore, we can predict the mental conditions that may next occur. For example, depressive state of schizophrenia will be decoded as 8-3 because this is the acute aggravation of schizophrenia. If the patient's state improves and turns into the usual chronic state, it is as recorded 8-0. When expressed in this way, changes in patient conditions are clear. At the same time, clinical comparative research, such as the effect of medicine and of biochemical changes at one time, becomes possible. When expressed in this way, changes in patient conditions are clear. At the same time, clinical comparative research, such as frequent attacks of acute aggravation will lead to organic degenerative changes and a deterioration of the personality. Similarly, electrical short circuit to irreversible damages to an electric machine. Next, I'll show you a treatment concept with the neo-organodynamic ways of thinking. In the organic disorder that was the essence of mental illness, rehabilitation such as psychotherapy, cognitive behavioral therapy, mental counseling, etc., is essential to recuperate loss of functions. For the positive symptoms, which are the secondary effect of organic degeneration, medication that focuses on the synaptic neurotransmitters will be effective. Theoretically, the anti-epileptics might be designated as a fundamental treatment for the acute aggravated phase. Because of the abnormal firing of the neural network, for the symptoms accompanying this firing phenomenon, the medication might not be restricted to conventional direction for use. Next, I'd like to propose concrete remedy strategy. I got the idea of this theory when I treated the acute psychotic patient with a brunoncerin that is an atypical antipsychotic. Brunoncerin is a dopamine and serotonin antagonist that has a unique D2 receptor blocking action. Brunoncerin has almost no sedative effect, but changes in the abnormal conditions of a patient can be observed directly. In our experiences of treatment in the acute psychotic states, hallucinations and delusions improved with brunoncerin. This phenomenon was observed in patients diagnosed as neurotic or psychotic. From the above, it follows that acutely psychotic states may be acute aggravation of chronic mental illness. Acute aggravation is a transient phenomenon. The essence of acute mental illness, therefore, must be traced to abnormal neural firing. Brunoncerin is called an atypical haloperidol. They have almost same D2 receptor blocking action. Theoretically, the neo-organodynamic changes in mental states will be observed in the case of haloperidol in the same manner as brunoncerin. The sedative effect of haloperidol probably disturbs observation of mental changes. Antiepileptics and brunoncerin are considered the main medicine in acute psychotic state. Next, I'll show you how to record a psychiatric chart in organodynamics. I propose the neo-organodynamism as a minimal clinical classification of mental illness for psychiatric treatment. By using this theory, those who are not psychiatrists will also be able to understand abnormal mental conditions and to determine treatment plans for patients. The prejudice against mental illness will pass away and the patient will be liberated. Thank you.